Hello guys, welcome back to the YouTube channel of The Concept Guy, and in this video we are going to talk about my GAIL interview experience. So what is GAIL? GAIL is actually Gas Authority of India Limited, that is a PSU, a Maharatna company in India, and it majorly handles natural gas production and processing, and also petrochemical sector in India. So guys, recently I actually gave the interview for the post of executive trainee in GAIL, and that was through the GATE 2021 marks, and the interview experience was really something that I really want to share, because it was held on 4th August, and if you don't believe me, then you will check this image where they sent an email, and it was conducted on 4th August 2021. So it is something that I've faced just recently, and so I can give you a very detailed overview of how the whole interview goes through, and what are the main things that you need to look at. Although the selection procedure is still going on, and it might be completed in few months, so I don't really know. I just want to share my experience so that you get a brief idea. Okay, this is not just any a video where I will be talking about what I mostly remember, but I am going to say tell you about each and everything. So it is a very detailed video, because I've recently given my interview, and therefore I remember exactly the same all the things that went through the interview. So stick to the end of this video and let's just start. Okay, so before starting, if you haven't subscribed yet, because of course many of you are watching the video but not subscribing, I will just say that subscribe it, because subscribing is free and it is easy, and you will get good content. So first of all, my interview happened on 4th August 2021, and so let me just begin from the very first, like the morning. So in the morning I got up, and I was really not well, so I had fever on that day itself, pretty bad luck you can say, but I still managed the interview, and let's discuss about that too. So in the morning I got up, and I was really not feeling well, had even fever, so took some medicines and got ready. So after I was ready, they sent an email around 9:45 to 10 a.m. in the morning, and when the mail came, they sent a link. Okay, a link to join the MS Teams. So Microsoft Teams, that is their platform where they took the interview online, and then we had to join through that link, they actually provide us different slots. Like, there are around 27 students, 26 or 27 students, I remember that. So around that much students are divided into various slots first. That also began at 10 a.m. but actually it was round up to like 10:15 a.m. the actual thing happened, slot division. And pretty much that of slot division till then, and then the first slot started was set to be start at 10:30 a.m. I was given the 12 p.m. slot, that's at the noon. So the next thing that I want to share is something that is really frustrating. So those who are about to give the interview or have given the interview, they can even realize that The slot timing was 12 p.m. but my interview started at 2:33 p.m. So that was a major difference in the slot timing, and that was pretty much kind of like we had to just open up the open and log in the MS Teams and just stay there staring at the screen and waiting for a turn. So it takes a lot more time. Okay, so you have to be really patient, and because nothing else that you can do. So they were saying your interview is next, but it was to be at 12, but it was actually held at 2:33 p.m. And even others face similar thing that I came to know with people. So first thing was that after the slot was divided, I don't know for what reasons the interview was so much delayed, and it was delayed in all the days. Like many people gave on 2nd August, many gave on 3rd August, I gave on 4th, and many on 5th and 6th as well. So it was like divided among the based on the ranks and all the things that they divided it, but it really took a lot of time for the slot, my interview to start, even after the slot was at 12 p.m. So be ready with it, okay? You might have to wait a lot, tough things, and moreover that I had fever on that day, so that was just crazy. So okay, let's just begin now. Once everything was set, my interview began. So the first thing they asked me was, okay, good afternoon, please introduce yourself, tell us about your family, tell us about your siblings, tell us about your hobbies, and the basic introduction. So I introduced myself very clearly, like that my name is this, I have done my BTech from da, and then again telling them about the CGPA, telling them about the GATE score, the GATE rank, telling them about the siblings in families and the family detail, a little bit of family detail because they actually asked in the introduction as well. So, and also they asked me where my father works, so explaining that to them. And then they moved on to my hobbies, that what are my hobbies, that apart from academics, what do I really love to do. So I really told them about my hobbies as well. So that was just the HR part, nothing more. They didn't ask questions like where do you see yourself after 5 years, no, nothing like that. So introduction was just a cool process and it was good. Now they moved on to asking that what is your favorite subject. So I had given my interview in chemical engineering, so ET, that is executive trainee in chemical engineering. So I told them that I really like chemical reaction engineering as one of the subjects, and I also like heat transfer and other subjects as well. So they say, then they asked me the chemical reaction engineering questions. So I really know the questions exact same to same. That's why I'm saying that this video is very important for you guys, because I know the exact questions, I know my exact replies, and I know how they reacted to the answers as well. So listen carefully this part, okay? Don't skip, because skipping would really make no sense of what's going on in the video. So first they asked me what type of reactors are available to us. So they asked me that what type of reactors are, or have I actually studied. So I'm this is an honest interview, like interview experience sharing, so I will share what I answered, and don't judge me on that, please. Okay, because in interview, however confident you are, you might answer weird sometimes. But yes, I answered correctly, don't worry. But just don't judge me, because different people have different answers at the point of the interview. So I told them about that. I basically know two types of reactors, one the batch reactors and the next continuous type of reactors. In the continuous reactors, I have also learned about CSTR and PFR. So if you actually want to say that bubbling fluidized reactor, FCC, fluidized catalytic reactors, then if you just tell these terms, then maybe you will be able to like gain an extra point in this, but then they will ask questions related to that. So be prepared, okay? This is something that I'm telling, like a tip to you guys, that if you, whatever you are telling them, they will ask the question from them. That is their guiding word, the keyword. To from that keyword, they will ask you the questions. So once I told them about the batch and CSTR PFR, then they told me that, asked me actually, they asked me that, which one will you prefer? So I told them that, they said that you have a CSTR and a PFR, which will you prefer? So I said that if we use CSTR when we want perfect mixing, and when the reactor comes in, we immediately get the product, as well as because of the mixing, we can actually have a good temperature control and control other parameters as well. So yes, it is used for that. And in for PFR, we use, it is like there is no axial mixing, there is only radial mixing. However, the for positive order reactions, the conversion is more for same volume. So if you want a good conversion at a particular volume, then PFR would be better. And but in PFR, we, the temperature control is slightly difficult, because throughout the intervals you have to actually control the temperature. So temperature control is something difficult. Also in PFR, the fabrication and the cleaning steps are something that are difficult, because as you know, it's just a long pipe and where the whole fluid flows. So these are something that I told them, but they were just not convinced or something as per their reactions. So they just told me that these are the advantages and disadvantages of the reactors. But why will you choose CSTR when you have PFR, because PFR gives more conversion. So I told them in certain cases the temperature control is really required, and also in negative order reactions, CSTR is more preferred. But they kind of like just kept on saying that you are just telling us about the advantages and disadvantages. So I was pretty much like, okay, these are the advantages and disadvantages, and therefore we use to get a thing. Like if we want better temperature control, we will go with CSTR. If we want better conversion, so we will go with PFR, kind of thing. So mention in the comments what you really think. I was just thinking about this only at the time of interview. So do mention what you think the answer could be, that they will be pleased with. Okay, so after that they said leave it. They move on to the next question. In the next question, they actually took a reaction. So A plus B gives C plus D. That is kind of a reaction, a reversible reaction. Now they told me that A and B are 5 moles each, and C and D are 6 moles each. Okay, so A plus B gives C plus D, where A and B are 5 moles and C and D are 6 moles. So obviously we can see by the reaction that the moles are increasing, so the volume will also increase. So it is a varying volume reaction. But then they gave me some cases. So case one was when we will increase the inerts and by keeping the volume constant. Now I was pretty much confused because at the start they told me that A plus B gives C plus D, where 5 moles plus 5 moles giving 6 moles plus 6 moles. Therefore, if we find the volume change factor, then perhaps the volume will increase. So I was just thinking about that, and I forgot that they also told me that there is constant volume in the case 1 with inerts. So basically I told them that if we add inerts, and their question was actually that which reaction will be favored, the forward reaction or the backward reaction. So first I thought for some time, and then I told them if we add the inerts, then the reactants are then getting up less space, because obviously the reactants and the inerts are coming in. And so if we have only reactants, then they are occupying a larger volume. Now the reactants are getting less volume at a particular cross section because it also has inerts with it. So I told them that because of that the reaction will be delayed and a larger volume would be actually required. But then they told me that you just think about it, which reaction will be favored, the forward or the backward. So I just thought because the reaction will take more time, so I just told them out of just like immediate response that backward reaction will favor. So that wasn't the answer. They told me that because they have considered a constant volume reaction, so even if we put the inerts, nothing will happen. Inerts will actually just be a safety parameter, but because the volume is constant, so there is no fractional change of volume, that epsilon that we denote it with. So basically the whatever the rate was at first, the rate will be the same because here the volume isn't changing. So that is what I missed the term. And then then they gave me a case number two. So case number two was when now the setup is similar, A plus B gives C plus D. Then they said that if we increase the pressure and decrease the volume, so now we are decreasing the volume and increasing the pressure, then which rate will be more, forward rate or the backward rate? So I thought for some time, and then I told them that the backward rate will be more. Again I told the same. Now here I give the reason that because it's a reversible reaction, now moles of the product are more than the moles of the reactant. And here when we increase the pressure according to Lee-Chatler's principle, so the backward reaction would favor more, because backward in the while in the backward reaction the products have more moles. So if we increase the pressure, so backward reaction will actually dominate over the forward reaction. They were really not convinced. I don't know why. I really don't know why, because actually the main thing is that they have a certain approach in their mind. So if that approach matches your approach, then only they will be convinced. Otherwise they will ask more for more reasoning, or ask you to think a little more. So they said that my answer is absolutely right, but the way I was making the thing, so that was not quite up to their mark. I don't know why, because it was just Lee-Chatler's principle involved. But they told me something that the reaction rate depends on CA, concentration, and concentration depends on pressure. So if we increase the pressure, the concentration will increase and the reaction rate will increase. But I really don't get it, that how can you really relate it with forward and backward reaction. So if you really think, if you just can relate to it, then do mention in the comments what you really think, because I hope the Lee Chatelier's principle one is a good answer. I really don't really think, and also my fever was getting so much high, so I really wasn't able to even think more, because and that it was just like they give you a little bit of time and you have to reply to them. Okay, so after this CRE stuff, they just move on to the heat transfer stuff, and that went pretty good, because I answered all of their questions, and but still I just don't know why they like behave in a manner that they are not convinced or something, but they say that that's the right answer, but they will just make a face like definitely that really makes us even more confused that whether we have answered correctly or not. But let's just move on to the heat transfer. So the heat transfer questions were, at first they told me how many heat exchangers I know, so I told them about the shell and tube heat exchanger, double pipe heat exchanger, fin type heat exchanger, plate and frame heat exchanger. So they told me to differentiate between them. So I explained that the shell and tube heat exchanger has a shell, a big shell with multiple tubes, and the tube and they so all the heat exchangers are basically divided, categorized according to their mode of operation and their contact area. So how the fluids will contact each other. So in the shell and tube heat exchanger, we have multiple tubes and a big shell. So there could be two pass, and also I just explain it a little more. Then for the double pipe heat exchanger, we have two pipes. The flow could be counter current or co current, and there are only two pipes involved, one over the other, and heat exchanger is through the inner pipe surface. So then I explained them the fin type heat exchanger, where the fins are added because the outer fluid is something that has less heat conductivity. So because of that, we need more area to increase the flux, so the heat exchange would be faster in that case if we have the fins. And then I also told them about the plate and frame heat exchanger. So that was just explaining the different types. Then he asked me, the interviewer asked me that, okay, so he just asked me that in a shell and tube heat exchanger, how we find out the heat transfer coefficient of in a shell and tube heat exchanger, how we find the heat transfer coefficient. So I tried to move it around, like I tried to explain the whole thing to them, like we first find the heat rate, that is MCP delta T. Delta T here is the in out minus in temperatures, and we find it for the cold and hot fluid as well. So then we move on to the Q is equal to UA LMTD, and here we have A as the area, LMTD is the log mean temperature difference, and the U is the overall heat transfer coefficient, and that we get by just from the individual heat transfer coefficients, like 1 by U is equal to 1 by HI plus 1 by HO. So the individual heat transfer coefficients. So then he asked me that how do you obtain the individual heat transfer coefficients? That was pretty good questions, because even in my BTEC project, I had to find out these values for design of the heat exchangers. So I looked up in the Paris Chemical Engineering Handbook, and also some journals, and also DQ Kern's book of process heat transfer. So there I got many heat transfer coefficients, individual heat transfer coefficients at various temperatures, and so it was kind of an experimental data, and I told them how I found it. So that was pretty good, and he was pretty much like convinced with the answer. So we move on to the next question, that what is LMTD and why we use it and not the arithmetic mean. So I told them that LMTD is the log mean temperature difference, that actually takes into account the whole path of the heat exchanger, because throughout the path the heat is being exchanged, the temperatures are changing, and therefore we don't take arithmetic mean there, because arithmetic mean will take out the average of the temperatures of the inlet and outlet. So we are not bothered about just the inlet and outlet, we are also bothered about the whole path of the fluid, the temperature profile in the heat exchangers. So we take LMTD, where you will notice that there is also a log term, because it is log mean arithmetic, and this log term actually indicates that we are considering the whole path, how the temperature is changing over the path, and hence we can find out the heat transfer rate. So also then he was pretty much like just okay, he was saying okay, that is the right answer, but his face was just like he wasn't convinced. I don't really know why, but do mention in the comments if you think something else is the answer. I would really like to see those comments too. And then the heat transfer part was covered, and then they told me that okay, thank you, and you may leave now. So the interview was over, but now let's discuss about the three main things. First is the what you should do before the interview, second is what you should keep in mind during the interview, and the third is what you should actually think about after the interview. So I'm going to discuss about these three things. So first thing is that what to do before the interview. So before the interview, just apart from just knowing the questions were quite simple, so you don't have to just go into very deep study. Okay, the questions were quite simple and just kind of the basic questions, but you have to think of answers that can actually convince them, because sometimes your answers would be right, but you have to make the approach in a way that convinces them. So that is something you can do properly if you have written the answers of the questions that you think might come in the interview. So write down, because whatever you write down, I also had written many things, many notes, but in the end I just even gave the answers correctly. But yes, convincing them is something, a major challenge that every student face. So prior to the interview, write down most of the definitions and things, like basic things, not so detailed, not so in depth knowledge, but just the basic things. So like why we use this heat exchanger, why not that, why we use this column, why not that. So these basic questions, so this is something that you need before the interview. Now during the interview, a lot of thing happens, and sometimes you might be even confused what they ask, because they kind of make it in a whole loop kind of thing. So to get out of that loop, you first, after listening their question, listen very carefully, because even you, if you miss some keyword, then the whole thing could actually trap you. So to get out of the trap, listen to their question very carefully. Like I missed the one of that constant volume thing. I missed that part because I was just thinking about that the reaction is something that where the volume must be varying because moles are increasing, but they mentioned it that there is constant volume. So listen to each and every word of theirs very carefully, then take some time. Okay, don't be in a hurry. I answered that inert part in a hurriedly manner, and therefore it actually went wrong. So but yes, apart from that, everything was right. So take some time, because after that I realized that I have to take some time, little time, to think and then answer. Because if we just try to answer in haste, then major chances are there that it will be wrong, or it will be something that is not appropriate according to them. So take some time, think, and then answer. Okay, also the language was no bar, but yes, the interview went in English. So but yes, sometimes they were speaking in Hindi also. So don't think about that. If you, whatever you are comfortable with, it's okay. And then the next thing is that during the interview, don't try to answer like just out of the box. Okay, like if you just don't know anything, then just admit it and say that, sorry sir, I am not able to recall that part. But yes, and don't even argue with them, because I didn't argue, but some of the students did, and it just messed them up. So don't argue with them. Never argue with them, because you cannot argue. Even if you are 100% correct, you cannot argue with the person who is in industry and who is interviewing you. Okay, so the last thing is that after the interview, what you should do. So after the interview, you should actually take on the notes, write the notes, what happened during the interview. Even write the questions, try to look for the answers and see how well you could have done it. Okay, so think of that time and think how you should actually make up things. Now it is kind of an experience, and the more experience you will get, the more better you will be at this. And therefore I shared my experience so that you get to know what things I faced, and don't really judge me. I had a really bad day at that time because my fever was just out of my control, and I even after waiting for such a long time, that also made my situation worse. But yes, I still managed to give the interview, because you cannot really change the interview date and time. So I hope you like this video. Please like, share and subscribe, because yes, you will get such great content, such detailed content, and I hope you just stay tuned for the next video. Thank you guys.